calcium of this.
Probably not much of a.
Yeah. That's reasonable.
My fault.
Or if you. Several. And you should. I would say useful. That's what I'm saying. That's a much. That's what I'm saying.
I'm gonna do it.
This is where it should be. So that the TCL should not get out. That's where it's at.
So right here.
Yeah, because it used to steal that from somebody else.
No problem.
So there's been a hush in the crowd. Apparently people realize what time it is. Dr. Jennings. All right, folks, let's go ahead and get started here. Order. So this is the PERC meeting. If by this point you haven't seen the note well, welcome to the IETF meeting. But hopefully you've been here most of the week and you know what this says. if you know about IPR related to any of this, anything you say on the floor, any contribution you make, let us know, disclose. Reminder of our milestones, that September 26th one is coming up. So it'd be good to start getting toward working group last call in this framework document if we're going to make that milestone. We'll see from the presentation today how close we feel we are on that. If not, we might have to talk to the AD about pushing out the date on that a little bit. But January 2017, so the remainders are in next year. So we should keep the tempo up on, and aim to meet those. We have adopted documents as of the last meeting or so for most of these, and I think most of these are on the agenda today. Still have a couple of gaps here. We need to figure out something with regard to this tunnel protocol, and we need to address the signaling a little bit more. So again, drafts welcome on integration with SIP and WebRTC, especially. This is the agenda today. Any bashes here?
Adam Roach. So this is the first time that I knew I was presenting in here. So I guess I should look at those slides.
I think this was as sent to the list as it is on the trackers. So who is presenting the, which draft is that? The double draft?
I hadn't read the list either, so I assumed I was presenting. So okay. I have some slides.
Great. Let's just bash this. That's fluffy. The other bash I was going to propose, I don't know if we've got all the right people here, but there's been some discussion on the list about SSRC immutability. So I was going to add a brief 10-minute slot for that. I'm going to take 10 from Paul to even him out and put 10 minutes after framework here to discuss that topic. Just to carve out a little bit of explicit time and see if we can get to that issue really nailed down. Any objections to that change? Or do we not, people think we don't need that time?
Sorry, Adam Roach. It's not that I don't think we don't need that time. It's the, there are two camps on this, and one of them is represented in this room pretty well, and the other one I think probably has no one in the room.
Okay, well, is Emil here? Hey, there he is. Great.
Okay. Emil is here. Never mind. Let's go ahead and do that then.
Thanks. Yeah, so I had heard from some working group participants there have been some discussions going on this week to clarify the issue for them, so I thought maybe we could kind of finally state things and try and put this to bed. Right. Emil, thanks. It'd be great if you could, you know, get as things are going, get thinking about, you know, how to state the case. Thanks. All right. I think we are... That's most everything. This is typical recap of as we've done. You know, maybe since we haven't talked in a while, you know, remember these are kind of layers we're talking about, and we're talking about creating something in between unencrypted conferencing and full SRTP. So adding this MDD as an intermediate entity. One other administrative note: we had been doing some virtual interims between the Yokohama ETF and Buenos Aires, but we've kind of taken a little bit of a pause in that tempo. Would folks be interested in scheduling some of these for the fall to kind of pick the tempo back up? Yep, thumbs up from Adam. Yeah, okay, good. So I'll start some traffic on the list to figure out when we want to do these and what topics should be. All right, so with that, I think we are over to David for some framework discussion. Let's see.
Now we're doing the slide
flipping. I have to drive. I cannot. I did not figure out how to.
Okay.
Magic display technology. Right, just let me know when to flip.
I will do that. All right, thank you. I don't know if everyone remembered, but in Buenos Aires, we adopted three drafts to be work group drafts. One of those was the framework. Everyone's read it, right, from beginning to end. Helped fall asleep to it, perhaps. But anyway, hopefully not.
I skipped way ahead of me here. Sorry.
Not too much. All right, so that's been now posted with a dash one. So if you'll go to my agenda slide, thanks. I'll just quickly describe what the dash one one differences are, which is relatively brief. And then just in case you could use a refresher or you didn't actually get a chance to read it, I'll hit a few highlights and then talk about what action items or list of things we think we might want to add to it or might not, as the case may be. And perhaps that'll spur some discussion about whether or not the list has got enough on it or too much or otherwise. Okay, next slide. As far as what's changed, primarily might have caught a typo or two at the same time, but primarily went through, and I actually should have said, added a co-editor, Christian Groves, and also went through and to try to make it a little bit easier to follow with perhaps a few less overuse of acronyms, changed the MDD to be media distributor and the key management function or KMF to key distributor. And so I think all but maybe one or two places acronyms are not used for those, just so it's a little bit easier to read. And that's primarily it. Next slide. Sorry, question? So into the just a quick refresher, I think we're pretty good about it now, but certainly when we first started about this topic, it was always difficult to talk about the word trust, because what we really mean in the PERC sense is that there are entities we trust to have access to media, and if we're the keys that would give them access to that, and other entities which are not trusted that, but otherwise might be trusted to do quite a few other things, but just not trusted to have access to the media. And as we try to describe in the framework, for simplicity's sake, we took a very simple model, but of course you can imagine some various permutations of this, especially with the reference to an endpoint that might actually be something that terminates PERC to non-PERC, could be a gateway, et cetera. But we're just, generically speaking, refer to it as an endpoint. And with that, and then hopefully media distributor and key distributor being in the untrusted and trusted domains, hopefully makes sense. And so with that, next slide, continue on with the refresher. So again, diagram that's also in the framework as an example. We're talking now about two keys, right? Two sets of keys. The end-to-end media keys ultimately that are both selected and transmitted by the endpoints, and then hop-by-hop keys, which you might also see referred to as inner and outer respectively. They probably mostly in the double draft. Next, yes. So the end-to-end keys, the generation of them is still the responsibility of the transmitters, the endpoints on their forwarding of media. And the confidentiality of those, i.e. so that the untrusted media devices do not get access to those keys and therefore to the media that's being encrypted by them, those are protected, or if you will, the confidentiality is enabled by a key encryption key, or as you'll see referred to presently, because I think there's interest in finding another name for it, the EKT key. And the EKT diet draft being the right place to go, and will be discussed later this morning as well for those details. We mentioned, of course, that while it's not neither required, it might be a really good idea, but we're not going to try to define what policy should or should not be followed, but certainly at least in the framework enable the possibility to change those keys during the life of a conference. And there may be several reasons you might think of, but maybe one obvious one when a new or old participant joins or leaves respectively might be a time to do that, as well as others. So we just want to make sure it works ultimately for that scenario. And I think go to the next slide. And then finally, where do the keys come from that I haven't already talked about, meaning the key encryption key, as well as in the design, the hop-by-hop keys between the endpoints and the media distributors, not between media distributors. Those come from again, previously referred to as the key management function, but we're just going to call them key distributors now. And that key distributor, we're going to talk about it in the context of the tunnel internet draft later for the most part, but that can live in, it's a logical function that can live in one of two places or others perhaps you haven't thought of, but in an endpoint, i.e. distributed if you want to think of it that way, or in perhaps a centralized location, of which we've showed a scenario we think is kind of a sweet spot where it's perhaps on the enterprise whose employing multiple service providers to host their conferences. But again, ownership of the device, it's going to be ultimately trusted to give out all that end-to-end or key encryption, key material. And I think that's all I was planning to cover here. So I can go to the next slide. All right, so finally now to getting on to some things that we've identified thus far as action items, things that maybe either need to be added to the framework or if it makes sense, added to in a separate internet draft or some combination thereof. But I thought I would also first address one that we haven't prioritized, but it was something that was always on our to-do list. And then maybe we got a first working list, if you will, that flared up on the mail list just in the last day or two. And that is what topologies in the 7667 draft, or RFC, does, given the requirements and constraints so far enumerated in our design, which ones qualify. So I think including, but may not be limited to the point-to-point translator and the switching, I forgot what SFM stands for. Switching forwarding.
Selective forwarding.
Selective forwarding. Thank you. Even I keep using acronyms. No, in the 7667, either to use the wording from the 767, it talks about a common or a not common across the interfaces of a SFM. And do you want to? Oh, okay. Well, the question was ultimately about what in the section 3.7 of the 7667. Yeah, keep all those numbers straight. RFC describes in the way of the selective forwarding middle box. See, I've used acronyms so much now, I've forgotten. And this is something I clarified with the team, with, and I think it was Magnus, to give him credit, responded a little over a year ago whether or not it was allowed to have either the termination or non-termination was my choice of words, but basically a common or a non-common space of SSRCs. Both are allowed in the SFM. So to try to then be specific-ish here in the form of bullets, those two. But when I read it a year ago, I could have swore I found a third one that might qualify. So I'm going to go back to my notes. Maybe it's not there. So if I were to put language in, these two may not be limited to. So that's one thing I think we'll get straight away into adding to the framework document. The other thing that we had kind of an open-ended, seemed like it wanted to be documented somewhere, or maybe not, if the group feels otherwise, to put any shall nots or should nots in the way of header extensions that perhaps should not be ever encrypted. So the audio activity metric might be an obvious one, right? So that you might want to say, don't do that. Or maybe that's just so obvious it doesn't need a list, but put it down as a maybe.
Ronnie Evan, I think it's a good suggestion, but I think you only need to specify the one that you definitely don't want the middle box to see, because the rest will be just like application decision, but at least the ones, that's what you want to put.
Okay.
Colin Jenks, I think we need to get that somewhere too. That's one of the few remaining issues in double, is that we need to have this somewhere, or at least advice on when you receive a packet with both, what you do. And depending on which header is. So yeah, I think something's needed here. And I have a slide on that later.
Okay. And I think this is my final slide of other stuff that we identified that maybe not in the order of any priority necessarily, given the order in which it's listed here, but other things we identified was that, for example, I work for Jonathan, as does Jonathan Rosenberg, as does Colin, and he's double and triple booked and sometimes joins multiple meetings at the same time. And so how would our key distributor know which ones he's in, for example, as well as what resources, since I think last time we decided it was likely going to be, maybe it was an interim meeting, that the key distributor is going to be the one to initiate any tunnel to the media distributor. It would probably need to know what resources are being allocated to that particular conference. So some sort of conference specific temporally short, probably, information may need to be conveyed in this framework that's not yet written up in there. So that was one. Here's one that I think we captured due to somebody mentioning it on the mail list. And again, whether it's obvious now or talk about it later, if there was interest in having like an announcement server being an example, but something in which was allowed to send in media, just not receive any. Right, so participate in it one way only sense in the otherwise end-to-end encryption running.
The first item, you're not really want to provide a conference-wide identifier. What you want really to do is to be able to identify to the key management, whatever you call it now, distributor, that which conference you want to join. But that's not part of the perk thing, that to do a conference management in that term.
Thank you. That, for what it's worth, we did not intend that to mean conference management. But did we, you know, do we have a gap that we need to fill, that some information that he distributed would need to know, whatever that is? I don't really want to define specific identifiers, but that some blob of information so it knew, in my Jonathan example, which conferences he was in that hour. Right.
That
it might be plural.
So I suspect that actually will come out of the work when we start talking about how to bind this to SIP and how to bind this to WebRTC.
Okay. Right. So that was just a breadcrumb to keep it on our list somewhere. We did already start a section then, just to go to my last point, but I didn't know about any comments on the one-way media idea. Or any, like, don't bother, because I'm always happy to take action items off the list.
Richard Barnes from the floor. So, I mean, obviously, if you've got have this media distributor in the middle that can just not send the packets, there is the requirement you're interested in here arranging the keying somehow, so that even if that guy screws up, this one-way entity can't decrypt whatever it gets.
I would have, okay, to put it in a way, based on what little we've talked about it, we would definitely want to make sure that was not possible. That even if it, that would be something inherently in it that even if it got media the other direction, it would not be able to decrypt it.
Okay. What's the use case here?
Like an announcement server would be one.
So imagine you are, imagine you're on a conference where every time somebody joins, the cloud says, you know, Helen Jennings joined the phone call. And that's run by the cloud service, and you don't really want the cloud service to have the keys to listen in on the conference. I mean, I think that's the general use case we're thinking about.
So as I understand, so I guess this is actually a requirement that EKT, it seems, to allow you to independently just disseminate the directional keys. And I can't remember off the top of my head whether that currently is the case. But if it is the case, and this is done, if it's not the case, then I guess it's a requirement in IQT that I guess probably would be worth doing if we're going to bother to do anything.
Jonathan Lennox, I'm curious how strong this requirement is. Like, if we look at this and determine that this, like, increases the complexity of the key management by an order of magnitude, are you willing to drop it?
We captured in here because somebody brought it up on the list and seemed cogent of an argument. No, if the room felt like that was complexity and opening security in a way that we'd like not to go there.
Okay.
I doubt too many people would be upset. So.
Yeah, I agree. We should look at the feasibility. While we're talking about key scheduling, I think I would like to flag that as something I think needs review and consistency, both in terms of how the keys are scheduled and how, you know, which keys wrap which and how they get passed around, and in terms of just what we call the keys. I think something the authors, I would hope the authors of the various drafts could do is get around and at least align terminology on what keys are what.
I think that this bullet is, to me, it looks like this bullet raises an issue which is not discussed, because the issue that is not discussed is we say that we want to that the MDD is not trusted with the media content, but this says that you don't trust him with the media distribution. Because otherwise he wouldn't send to the announcement server the media, because he only needs to receive from him. He's not sending to him in terms of how he connects to him. But now you're saying, no, you don't trust him. You may send him something. And I think that's something we need to address, to decide what are our requirements in terms of how we trust the MDD in terms of media distribution.
I'm assuming this is an end-to-end requirement for the purposes of this discussion. And the end-to-end requirement, therefore, is that you need different directional traffic keys. So the way the GLSSRTB works is you extract different traffic keys in each directions anyway. But as I think through this, I realize that this and I can't remember how EKT works, but it seems to me that this actually requires extracting four keys. Namely, you have to extract a RTP key in each direction and an SRT and an RTCP in each direction. Because presumably you do want the announcement server. I mean, I guess maybe you don't. It's an announcement server doesn't. I mean, the announcement server doesn't process RTCP or does it? Sorry, it's okay, good. That's what I assumed. Right.
We have 1 minute left in this slot.
Okay. So yes.
Let's maybe put a pin in this one.
So I think I think this is probably relatively straightforward, but it may require some substantial surgery to EKT.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't necessarily make it a high priority personally, but
please be brief.
Okay. I think you can steal some time from my slot. I don't need it now that we're moving the SSRC conversation. So steal some time here. The use case that sort of drove this to the announcement server, I don't think it's that. I mean, this, as Ecker points out, EKT doesn't support this. This would complicate the key in EKT, but we could do it. I think that the use case that drives this, when somebody joins a conference or whatever type of announcements, you can deliver those completely out of band and however you deliver roster information, other things from the conference and bridge this thing so that we don't need to deliver it through the audio channel. So I don't see a strong need for this, for me personally.
Okay.
Paul Jones. So what I had envisaged for this, so and I actually drafted out the syntax for it, was that what we would do is actually send down a direction indication in the EKT message that goes from the key server to the endpoints, so that when the endpoint receives an EKT message, not the EKT field attached to the actual media packets, but the EKT message that comes down from the key server down to the endpoint, it would actually have a spy value. They would end, there's always a spy value. There's, you know, you can have 65,535 or so different spies. And now it's only 15 bits. Sorry, 32,700. Anyway, so the spy value would actually indicate, so you'd have a spy value and have multiple keys, and there would also be a direction indication on that spy field. And that would be a way of telling the endpoint, here's a key, but this is for receive only, right? And then that same entity would hand the announcement server or whatever a spy value with the same spy value with a key and say, for you, this is transmit only. And that was kind of the way I was thinking about doing it. So it isn't in EKT right now, but it would be really trivial to add without introducing a lot of complexity, I think.
Out of motion, at the risk of designing from the floor, it occurs to me we already have hop-by-hop keys that we are using between the mixer and the media, what do we call it now? The media distributor and the endpoint. And so there might be a solution here where we don't have to open up EKT for surgery if we just use that one key instead of having, you know, an additional end-to-end key for these types of things.
Yeah, I think the overall point is we need to study the key schedule and see how hard this looks.
Mozinetti, I think this was discussed last time, and one of the proposals was to, actually maybe even two meetings ago, one of the proposals was to allow mixing of perk and non-perk media. So these send-only endpoints would not be anything to do with the perk conference. They would just send regular SRTP as they do today, and the MDD would hop-by-hop them themselves, and it would just come in as a, you know, regular one single encryption layer scheme, not double. But I think one of the points mentioned was that it would be difficult for an endpoint receiving that stream to have any kind of trust. Like, clearly the MDD is forwarding it to it, so it knows it's not, you know, a random attack from anywhere, but it wouldn't know whether or not the media that's in there is a simple, harmless, you know, announcement tone, or it's, you know, Richard saying, you know, hell no. The answer is hell no. So I think people were pushing back on having this and doing like Colin said, maybe push it to an application layer thing so that if you have some certain level of trust in some other things for signaling simple stuff, that should come outside, out of band, because it's difficult for the endpoint receiver to know whether or not something that it's going to play out as media is really trusted or not.
Okay.
Shortening the action item list is probably welcome. All right. Well, just in my final, well, I guess I'm over, but final moments here. We did start a section on identity trust. So in other words, those that is really Joe's endpoint. How is that going to be enabled? And there's probably multiple options on that. So this is really a call to elaborate more on that and whatever's going on the identity front elsewhere in the IETF or WebRTC. All the above. So there's plenty of work to do. It's a short if nothing else, takeaway. And with that, I'm done.
All right. Thank you, David.
Somebody's taking notes, by the way.
Yes, we have two note takers. Emil, would you like to come talk to us briefly about SSRCs and immutability?
I just...
Oh, did you send me some?
I tried to put a couple of slides.
Talking points. Let's see.
If you can't use them, that's okay.
Did you send them to me in email?
Yeah.
Maybe start talking and I'll see what I can do.
Okay.
So, how to start? So currently, PERC says that an MDD cannot rewrite SSRCs. There has been a lot of discussion around this. I'm one of the concerned parties because to me, this is quite problematic. So SSRC overwrites today are primarily used for a few things. Things like active speaker switching. You have, you're always showing one SSRC as the main stage speaker, and the media distributor basically changes whoever goes into that SSRC. This is also used for things like last N. You always receive a set of SSRCs and in a larger conference, and the people who actually go into them are replaced by the media distributor. And then there's also simulcast. That is... Thanks, Jonathan. And then there's also, Then there's also simulcast, which is the sender sends multiple layers, but only one of those layers goes to the receiver. And from the receiver perspective, this is a single coherent RTP stream. So there's absolutely no support for simulcast or understanding even of simulcast on the receiver side. Now, I feel that those two are potentially less of a problem, or at least I don't feel that strongly about them, maybe because we don't use them. If anyone feels strongly about them, then they should speak up. I'm specifically concerned about the simulcast case because today, well, for various reasons, but maybe the one to begin with is today there's only one way to implement simulcast so that it would work with WebRTC, and that is SSRC overwriting. Next slide, please. Now, there is a work in the IDF on, there is work on the IDF on implementing another way of doing simulcast and another way of presenting it to the receiver, and that way is based on RID. Now, there are a few concerns that I have with this. I'm not opposed to this approach at all, but the concerns that I have are, this is not clearly specified yet. So we do not have, I've talked to at least seven or eight different people today, and every time someone comes with a new nuance, no, it actually doesn't work exactly like this, it works a little bit like this. So this is not a very, this has work that has to be done on it before it's ready. So again, making it a dependency for the entire PER group sounds a little bit risky to me at this stage. It is also implemented by no WebRTC implementation today. So neither Chrome nor Firefox nor Edge support the receiver side of this today. It is the motivation for me as an SFU implementer to add support for RIDs is also not very strong because it would not give me any new features outside of PERC. So to me, that basically just increases the cost of implementing and supporting PERC. And it's the same in my mind for browser implementers. Like, why would you do it given that you already have simulcast support in other ways? So it just increases the cost of PERC. And supported this one, I sort of thought it was implied by my arguments, but Mo said yesterday that if I thought it was a problem, I should explicitly state it. So here I go. If I, as an SFU implementer, want to support simulcast with RIDs, that would basically require me to have two branches of code, two implementations shipping concurrently, because I cannot rely on no endpoint starting to support simulcast reception tomorrow, right? There would be some that would have it at first and some that wouldn't. So for years and years, I would have to ship with two simulcast implementations. So all these arguments are not against RID. I want to make that clear. All these arguments are against making RID the only way you can use PERC. And next slide, please. This is the last one. That's right. So the implication of the change that I'm asking for PERC is not to prohibit reusing SSRCs. It is not to prohibit use of RID. I'm just asking that this shouldn't be the only way PERC can work. Just basically, there's PERC can very easily be made to work with support for changing SSRCs. You only need to make sure that the original SSRC is somehow communicated to the other end, and that's it. So to my mind, the code for alleviating my concerns, which I believe are substantial, but that's just me, is not the cost for that is not high for PERC, and that's these are my talking points.
Great, Peter. Thanks,
Peter. Peter Thatcher. So two things. First, I don't really think that the distinction between SSRCs and RIDs here is the main issue. Like RIDs are just there so you don't have to signal your SSRCs, but the real issue at hand is still there even if you signal your SSRCs. So I think that's kind of a red herring. The real issue is whether the endpoint can receive simulcast or not. So that comes to my second point, which is if you're worried about using PERC in WebRTC, I would suggest that there's a whole lot more that needs to go on in order to make PERC work with WebRTC than just receiving simulcast. And receiving simulcast would be like a very small part of it.
So you're saying there's so much work to do, so why not add a little bit more?
Like, if you're saying we can't have PERC work, if PERC requires receiving simulcast, and you're saying we shouldn't do that because then it can't work with WebRTC, I'm saying like...
No, I'm not saying that. So clearly, both paths are implementable. It's all about the amount of work and hassle that they each require.
Given how much work and hassle is going on, I think saying...
Why not add a little bit more?
In a future version of WebRTC that supports PERC, can we also support receiving simulcast?
We can.
Yeah, so I don't think that's...
But why is my question?
It's a small thing to add,
but why
to everything else?
It's a small, but why add it?
Well, ORTC already supports receiving.
I've heard numerous times that people were asking themselves whether or not they should actually remove that feature because no one's currently using it. And again, that doesn't answer my question. Fine, let's say that this is implementable. Why make it mandatory given that we can argue about the amount of work that it represents.
I'll let other people argue about that. I'm just saying.
Adam Roach. So one of the key arguments you put up here, I'm not saying it's the only one, is that RID is not completely done yet, so we can't rely on it. Now, I'll point out the RID and simulcast work is significantly more mature than the PERC work at this time. The key drafts, there's one that is past working with last call, about to be in front of the IASG. The other two simulcast-related drafts in M-Music are going into working group last call now. We are not working group last calling anything in this group anytime soon. So to claim that somehow the simulcast work is going to hold us up is it doesn't match the facts on the ground. Now go back a slide.
I'm not saying that it would hold it up. I'm saying that making it mandatory for PERC is unclear what we are subscribing to exactly and how much harder exactly this is making life to implementers.
It's the specific thing, it's not clearly specified yet, implemented by no one currently, right? So
yep.
It's ahead of PERC. So it's not blocking PERC. These first two bullets.
No, it's not blocking. I'm not saying that it's blocking.
That's what these first two bullets are saying. Those are not reasons. Take them off the table.
Okay. So can I, exercise the chair's prerogative and ask a question here? Is anyone in the line, would anyone in the line like to address the benefits of having immutable SSRCs? I think that would be a good thing to have.
Immutable, right?
I'm sorry, the benefits of immutable SSRCs.
I'm Colin Perkins. I'd partly like to address that question.
Okay, great.
So I think that there are, well, I have a sort of architectural comment and a comment on the technical specifics. Architecturally, it seems that we could implement this modulo, my next comment, in either way. We're choosing in either way, either
with the middle box rewriting the SSRCs or with immutable SSRCs. I believe to a large extent the discussion to have is where we want the complexity. Do we want receivers that are not aware of what's happening and the smarts in the middle box, or do we want a simpler middle box and the receivers have to implement some extra features? And that's not so much a technical argument as a design decision and a design philosophy question. So I think trying to motivate that based on the specifics of, you know, what's at what point in the standards process is not the right thing. It's what, how do we want the resulting system to look? The technical point I had, up until you got to the very end of your comment, and then you says, well, of course we need to carry the original SSRCs. I thought this was fine. But that comment makes me very nervous. Because if you have two sources coming into the middle box and their SSRCs get rewritten and sent out,
mm-hmm.
and the original SSRC is retained, what happens if they pick the same SSRC for the original SSRC?
You can make them handle the, not conflict, but what's the word? The collision.
Because everything's being rewritten.
No, it's very easy for the SFU to indicate that there's a collision to the endpoint. So
the original SSS, right. So the question is, does the collision, the SSRC collision resolution work through one of these middle boxes, which is rewriting SSRCs and maintaining the original SSRCs as well? And does everyone implement that?
Yeah,
right. Because yes, so there's something that needs to be defined there and make sure it works.
Absolutely, it has to be a rule like CSRC, this new header field.
No.
Mozane, so this new header field, if you allowed rewriting, this new header field would have to be treated just like a CSRC. No. It has to be part of the collision detect.
But this is not how CSRCs work.
This is how things would have to work to have a common SSRC space. Yeah. Everything that's in that common space has to be checked against collision detection.
Sure. My point is there's something to specify here.
Oh, yeah.
It's not as simple as just carrying the original SSRC.
Agreed, but that something is not necessarily very complicated either.
Mozane, so I thought I understood yesterday very clearly what you did. Now I'm more confused. So let me go back and say what I thought was your original main point, that if you go back up a couple of slides, the one that said the last in and then simulcast, the different, active speaker switching, last in and simulcast. Okay, so this is where I thought you were coming from, that in a particular architect, non-PERC architecture today, in a particular way that an SFM is implemented, the architecture that you pick may be that you have three people joining the conference, you create, you know, you get three M lines for the receivers, and you say, this is always Emil, this is always Richard, this is always Mo. Okay. And then you're asking for send simulcast from each one of them.
Yep.
And WebRTC supports that just fine. So they're all sending you a couple of different qualities of themselves.
Yep.
And then the SFM is deciding which one to forward down to all the receivers.
Correct.
Send big Emil, little Mo, little Richard. You know, it'll keep sending different qualities to different people, but towards any one receiver, Richard is always still Richard, Emil's still always Emil, Mo's still always Mo.
Correct.
And the thing that's changing is the qualities of Richard, Emil, and Mo are changing, but to the receiver, it's kind of transparent because you're writing the SSRC.
Yes.
So at the media layer, there's just a single decoder pipeline. There's just a single instance of Richard. There's a single instance of Emil, single instance of Mo. And that decoder sees resolution changes happening, but you think resolution changes are supported fine by everything because it's just been there for a long time. What you're afraid of, though, is that if all of a sudden, every time you wanted to switch the quality of Richard, you have to send him a new SSRC that would whack the entire pipeline, the entire decoding pipeline for Richard. So you don't do that. Your SFM architecture is, no, I'll rewrite everything to keep your decoder instance up, and I'm just switching. It looks like resolution switches inside of the same media stream. Whereas all of a sudden, if you start switching SSRCs, then you see an entirely new source and it tears down a lot of stuff and resets a lot of stuff. And that's why some architectures have chosen to do receive different qualities. I'm not going to call that receive simulcast, because that to me is something totally different. This is receiving different qualities of someone, only one of one quality at a time, switching across different qualities of them. That's one way people can do that with SFMs today, right? And you think it's the only safe way because a lot of devices may not support a lot of endpoints.
No. The only way to do it with WebRTC today.
It's explicitly forbidden. That's the other big confusion. Don't say receive simulcast because you're not talking about receiving multiple calls.
I mean simulcast switching. Awareness of the receiver.
Switching
maybe
qualities.
It is true that you can. Yes. Okay. Maybe it is true that you can make your receiver aware of the fact that there are multiple streams and have them change video tags on the receiver site. And we've actually tried to do that. And there's no way you can make it work well because at a WebRTC client level, you do not have enough information to do the switches at the right time and make them imperceptible and make them work so well as this thing works. So yes, not entirely impossible, but doesn't work well.
Right. Okay. So given that backdrop, that's why you're rewriting to avoid tearing down pipelines at the receivers, to avoid the receivers doing a bunch of work that you think is going to impact the experience. Right?
Yes, pretty much yes.
Okay, but if the receivers were able to very quickly see and detect those SSRC changes and not have a disruptive experience with them, then you would be fine with that architecture, right? It's because they don't do that today. That's why you're worried about having that architecture in PERC.
If you want to have me not worried at all, then from tomorrow, every endpoint has to start supporting this and someone else has to do the work on my side. If I have to do the work, I'm a little bit worried. I'm still happy to do it. But maintaining two sorts of doing simulcast at the SFU is also a concern for me. And I'm not super hot about it.
Okay. So just to make sure everybody's clear, the main thing that you're worried about is that a receiver, when he sees big and little Emil, when he sees a switch in quality between big and little Emil, you want that switch to be the same SRC. Yeah. You want
same
to look like the resolution
of
switch. From the original sender versus where if you're doing immutable SSRCs, that has to be an SSRC change. That's the core issue that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm going to give this 5 more minutes or so. So let's start wrapping up.
So I don't even know how that would work with audio. I just don't need it
for audio at all.
Okay. Fascinating. I think Bernard made a wrong statement there that WebRTC forbids receiving simulcast. That's simply not true. It does not require browsers to send it as all. Send it to me on the email list, please. Send it to me on the email list. Point to it. So I think the important thing to understand, a couple things that are important here is one. Part of the reason there was many ways we could have done simulcast, and the way the browsers have decided to go forward in the simulcast and the specs and what the many of them have committed to implementing is this RID-based approach, right? That's the direction we're going. And a big part of what choosing that actually was that the alternative approach of a purely SSRC-based one was encumbered with some IPR that was easily avoided by going a different direction. The ITF generally prefers that. So that was one of the arguments in favor of using SSRC. The other thing that you haven't really approached is on this SSRC, we brought up a pretty serious splicing attack that can happen from a security point of view. And I don't understand how you fix that if you allow SSRC to be rewritten by the middle box. And we discussed that for a long time with a lot of slides on things. I just don't see how that's solved in this scenario.
Okay, well, I don't know what that hack that is, so I'm not able to answer your question right now. I don't know if it applies to our case. I don't know, to some other architecture, so I'm not able to
answer
this.
It's been brought up on the list before. There's slides that were presented by Ericsson on it.
Can you summarize briefly, Colin?
So if the middle box can switch SSRCs, you can basically take packets from one person with their SSRC, pretend there are packets from another person with SSRC, and insert.
So I have answered that command on the mailing list, and that is easily resolved by just having the original SSRC be communicated to the receiver as part of the packet.
And how do they know which ones they're supposed to be expecting? Like what? Like at this point, you're asking the receiver to do the same thing as if it didn't do SSRC switching in the first place, right? You're asking for the type of change, the changes that the endpoint would have to do at that point would be the same as not allowing the SSRC to change.
No, that's purely, no, there are no changes that need to be done. That is a change that is purely on the PERC layer. What I'm concerned about in the current situation that your changes that PERC is requiring are on the simulcast layer. So in order to do PERC a certain way, I have to do simulcast.
Endpoint has to do this on receiving it. It's a substantial change to what the endpoint would have to do on receiving it.
It is purely
part of the PERC.
So it's
not going
to
work with the existing things that do simulcast today. It would have
PERC
a huge
is not going to work
hole.
With the existing things. This is purely part of the PERC code.
Okay, but your argument, if you would like to be able to work with endpoints that do this simulcast stuff
saying,
today.
That's not what he said.
Do you want to say it again for me so I understand?
You want me to repeat what he said? Sure. Says, okay. But as I understand what Emil is saying, is that he is going to need to maintain this mechanism in his code base until every endpoint which understands the new way. You know, every endpoint that only understands the new way is gone decommissioned.
Sure.
And so he does not want to have to maintain two independent, maintain and debug and quality test two independent simulcast implementations.
So let me say what I'm saying again. Okay. So for all of those endpoints that are using that old method, there is a huge security vulnerability, and I see no reason why the ITF should endorse that.
I don't agree that there is one.
Jonathan Lennox. So two points on this. First of all, I think what this is actually talking about is what RTP topologies we support. Basically, what Emil wants is a different RTP topology than the SFM without with consistent SSRCs.
Mm-hmm.
It might be SFM with consistent SSRCs. It might be media switching mixer. I need to reread the draft to figure out exactly which one it is. I think this kind of gets somewhat into the framework discussion and that impacts this. The other point I wanted to raise is the thing I raised on MMusic and AVT Core about there are use cases in a conference where you want to send the same source twice, which is to say, you know, the use case I had was I have both one conceptual loudest speaker and one conceptual I want to constantly view my boss. And sometimes my boss is the loudest speaker. I want him to show up both in the my boss window and the loudest speaker window. If you don't have SSRC rewriting, that's not, you know, you need to have multiple MIDs for a single source, and everybody hates multiple MIDs for a single source. And I got a lot of pushback on that, which is to say we're either going to need multiple MIDs for a source or SSRC rewriting to get that use case to work.
Miguel Paris of Curento. Well, some people have suggested to solve this problem, the problem of the simulcast receiving it in the reserver site. And I don't agree with that. It could be a solution, but the problem is the quality of experience and the overhead added in the receivers. From our experience, the problem is now is that the bottlenecks is in the browser side. The browser side cannot decode a lot of streams. If you add the overhead of decoding simulcast and perform the switching, we're going to reduce the scalability of the whole system. Okay. So from my point of view, I agree totally with Emil, and this must be done in the media distribution side. Nowadays, we need to rewrite the SSRC. There are another possibilities like use read or meet, but we should take into account that we have this possibility in the context of the WebRTC. So I think that now we should respond the question of why SSRC must be immutable. I don't understand why. Thank you.
Agreed.
Ronnie Evan. So I think that this discussion is like Jonathan said, is more the discussion which topologies we support. And I think it's more than that, because it goes back to what our expectation. The point that you were making were that you prefer that the middle box will be smarter because you cannot count on the endpoint to support certain features. And that's the world I come from. I'm not from the WebRTC. I came from the world where you have multiple endpoints and some middle box that does the conferencing. So in my view, I think that that's the right direction to go. Now, I heard Colin concern or what in the past Ericsson was said, and I think this is, I mean, he says it's security that the middle box will pass something that it was not supposed to pass. And that's relevant for any implementation of a middle box, okay? And the reason we are making it here is the trust issue. And that's what I made in my previous content, is that we definitely defined that PERC is doing trust on the content of the media. We didn't say anything about whether the middle box is trusted in terms of what it sends to the users or not doesn't send to the users. And that's something we have to agree on. So if we say it's not trusted on what it will distribute, then I understand the point why you don't want to change, to allow to change the SSRC. Otherwise, I don't see the point for that.
So Paul Jones, just one comment on changing the SSRC values as a general thing. So we're doing two levels of encryption. One is hop by hop, one's end-to-end. If we change the SSRC, we could only do that on the hop-by-hop anyway. End-to-end, you're still going to get the same SSRC as the original sender, unless we're going to change SRTP. So even if we change it, the receiving endpoint's still going to have that original SSRC value.
We've had that argument. End-to-end, what we're currently doing, that's not SRTP. Now, you might want to make it work with your SRTP stack, but that doesn't mean it's SRTP. That's not SRTP. So the constraints of SRTP do not apply there.
Well, wait, but the point, my only point is you're going to get the original SSRC value.
Yeah.
Regardless.
Yeah, you are going to get it.
Yeah.
The question is, where do you get it? Do you get it? And that too. Is it going to be in an extension? Is it going to be part of the header? Does it mean that this is your source? Does it mean that it's your original source and you're only using it to validate identity? These are the differences. But there's no compromise in security, nor breaking SRTP.
Yeah, I'm not pointing out the security thing, other than just to say that it's there anyway. Same thing with, we did the sequence number rewriting. Okay? If we put it in a header extension, we're still getting the original sequence number value. So the original values are there. And then it becomes a question of how the endpoint's going to react to that. Does it use the outer values? Does it use the inner values? Mm-hmm. Those are things to think about. Whenever we change even the sequence numbers or we change the SSRC values, either way, that's something that we haven't fully covered in the architecture document, for example.
All right, I think I'd like to go ahead and wrap up now. Neil, thanks. I think return you to your seat. So what I'd like to get a feel for is whether we people feel like they at least understand the same set of trade-offs. We at least have agreement on what the trade-offs are on the two sides here. So what I'm hearing here is that on the one side, if we continue to require that SSRCs are immutable, we have somewhat of a dependency on RID, perhaps a soft dependency, but there's some dependency nonetheless. And as Jonathan pointed out, we may have some issues with multiple MIDs. On the other hand, if we allow SSRs to be mutable, as Colin pointed out, we have some ambiguity and some complexity around how you select which SSRC you use, the original or the outer one. And as Colin raised, there may be some issues around splicing attacks that have been pointed out on the list. So does everyone feel like that's a fair summary of the trade-offs in the two cases?
And Colin Perkins also raised you need to redefine how SSRC collision works.
Yeah, some issues around collisions. I was kind of wrapping that in the whole issue of how you select and use the two values you get. Everyone feel that's a pretty fair summary of the trade-offs involved here? Okay, seeing nodding around the room. So given that, let me just take the sense of the room here. I'll take a quick hum, and the two options will be in keeping immutability as a requirement, and on the other hand, allowing SSRCs to be mutable in some cases. So if you're in favor of keeping a requirement that SSRCs are immutable, please hum now. If you'd be in favor of relaxing that and allowing mutability in some cases, please hum now. Okay, so it's good that we agreed on the trade-offs. I was hearing nothing overwhelming on either side, slightly stronger in favor of mutability. So obviously we don't quite have consensus right now. what I will do is summarize that in the agreement we got to on trade-offs in the list, and hopefully we can drive this to conclusion on the list. Colin.
So my recommendation would be that the people who are in favor of immutability write a draft that shows how all the parts, you know, that's a draft that deals with immutability. So it says what we're going to do on the endpoints with this, you know, addresses all the issues that were raised and says, here's the changes we need to make all the place to allow immutability. Here's a proposal for it. Sorry, did I say that backwards? I'm basically saying Emil should write a draft that says, here's how it would work in the world I'd like, and here's how we deal with all the issues. There's no actual draft that anyone can review on that to see what the issues are and what would need to be changed. And then we can have a look at that, and we'll be able to decide whether we want to adopt that as, you know, as the way the working group goes forward or not. But we need a draft.
I agree. Emil, is that something you'd be willing to do a little work on?
Are you asking me to define PERC fully with SSRC immutability? Yeah.
I think what we would need to know is, like, what are the processing rules that an endpoint applies to select, you know, to take two values and come out with one that it uses?
I'm sorry, I'm not super clear on exactly what I'm being asked to do. If I'm asking to do the work of the entire working group just to make a single point, then no.
What I'm asking is write down all the things that will have to be put in various documents to allow this to work. Okay, we have a fully set of worked examples of current ones that people have written down, right? I mean, like, you'd write, you know, that document needs to change to allow the double needs to change to allow.
Right. So if you're asking me to
but what I'm asking you to address is all the issues people have been raising about, and we're going to have to write a document that explains how the endpoints deal with these two SSRCs and how SSRC collision works and how splicing works and what you do in these things, right? Like, I'm saying, write down what changes are needed for us
right.
to
okay.
be able
so
to
So you're asking
this.
Me for a pull request on Dabble that says, here's
no,
how we
there,
can work.
This is something you keep misunderstanding, is a lot of things need to change, not just this one thing. It's not just we need to change a line in Dabble that says you can change this. We need to describe what happens on the endpoints when this happens. And, you know, your statement that it's not SRTP anymore that we're using on the inside, I mean, that was left me like, whoa, that's a pretty big change, right?
So, Colin,
it is not SRTP, Colin. Colin, SRTP is not applied twice on RTP packets.
So how about, Colin, if you could send a list of questions you have that ambiguity.
When there is a draft, I will send a review of it. But no, I'm not setting it up ahead of time.
I'm not even aware what the concerns are, because I've addressed them all on the mailing list. So I'm not even aware what
I think
the security concern is not a concern. I've addressed it. And
right.
I can address the one from Colin that talks how to deal with SSRCs.
All right, folks, we need to wrap this up and move on to some other topics. Ronnie, did you have something quick?
Yes, I think it's only my understanding what it's tied to is just to do the same for the SSRC as you're doing to the sequence number and explain also the issue. That's all that's need to be addressed, because the other concern, the security concern, has nothing to do with this document. It has to do with the definition what PERC is.
Yep.
Colin Perkins, it might be useful if someone writes a draft that lists the concerns.
Yes. Were you volunteering for that?
No.
All right, I think we have to move on.
Because I'm not sure I understand them well enough.
Yeah. So yeah, I think we have to move on from this at this point, but thanks. So next on the agenda is Dabble, who is presenting that? I think Colin. I'm unable to make this work for some reason. Escape.
Before Cohen starts, I just wanted to point that I will send a document describing how the problems that were raised here will be resolved.
Okay.
Just to have it for the minutes, to have some closure on this.
Thank you. All right, Colin, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Next slide. So not a lot of changes on this draft. These were things that we agreed at the last meeting. Mostly the removal of the null stuff that could be added back later if we ever wanted. There's a registry and stuff for it, but it's removed for now. Next slide. This gets to the point that David was making earlier. We have a sort of hand-wavy part of the draft where we know that it makes total sense for the client for the mixer to insert some RTP header extensions, and we sort of suspect there might be some that we wouldn't want it to insert. Or more, and then we have the issue of if you found a given header extension that had been inserted by the original client and by the mixer, which one do you do? Okay, and so this is one I was hoping to get some input from on today. So next slide, please. In fact, we'll see which. No, back slide. Okay, we got a difference. You got an old version of slides, but it's fine. Doesn't matter. So an example of one which clearly we want the mixer to be able to, or the media distributor to insert, would be the mixer to client audio levels. Okay, that's something that if you believe this had
So there is no mixer. There's no mixer, so there's no such information.
Okay, so we don't need this one.
What?
So the client is going to insert a client to mixer level, right? Do you want the MDD to copy the values it finds in there into a mixer to client level?
It doesn't even know what's the audio. It doesn't see the audio, so it cannot do
it. It knows it's audio. It knows what to do with it, right? It's outside.
No, so it only gets the information from the client to mixer. That's the only thing that it can pass forward. There's nothing else.
Okay, so it has the information. So no need for that one then? Okay, fine. Are there any headers of all the headers? Is there any ones that you want the mixer to ever be, or the media distributor to ever be able to insert in this?
So call these recurrent slides.
Awesome.
Is that what you
edit them as we go here? If anyone says anything useful.
So Paul Jones. Well, the obvious one is the OHP, because that may get inserted by the.
Sure. The OHP, obviously, yes, yeah.
So John, so the MID is the answer.
Okay.
MID is absolutely. Is absolutely required for this to work with bundle.
Yep. No question about it.
That's there's.
So I'm going to ask this two question. I'm glad to get feedback from everybody here.
What?
Are there any that we definitely don't want it to edit? I tried to pick an example. Like CVO is one that it doesn't really make sense for the middle to be changing that, given it's sort of coupled with the original video.
Yeah, I think we discussed this somewhat at one of the interims. What I kind of feel like is, there are some header extensions where I'm like, well, I don't see a reason for it and whatever. I don't recall that I saw anywhere I really felt like, it was, it really hurt, hurt security wise to actually have end to end, to not have end to end either authentication or privacy.
I went through them all and came to the same conclusion.
Yeah, basically, I feel like, and I think our conclusion at that point was we couldn't think of any, but retrofitting this to add them later would be really hard. So I'm not sure what to do, but I would certainly, it's much easier to say, never mind, we're not doing end to end headers, but retrofitting end to end headers on later, if we need them, would be really hard.
Christian Groves, just in answer to the question, is there any that we would want to rewrite? The ones related to Clue, the capture ID. Yeah.
Would definitely.
Emilio, so I think the complexity here is that we're trying to answer too broad of a question, and I can think of a bunch of extensions that I want to introduce in the SFU, like for example, app send time, things that are not even standard. So in my mind, it'll be easier to answer on a per extension basis when some extension needs to be end-to-end. It would explain how it needs to be end-to-end and how it needs to be treated by per candidates. That's my suggestion.
Peter Thatcher. So why do you need MID?
Because the upstream MID is not the same as the downstream MID.
Why not?
What?
Why can't... Why do they need to be hop by hop?
What?
Why do the mids need to be hop by hop?
Because mid is negotiated on each, because you're doing, you know, the offer answer between the endpoint and the media distributor.
So you tell the sender to send with the mid that you want the receiver to see.
So you have to do mid collision detection?
Mids are chosen by the offerer.
Mids are chosen by the offerer, which is usually going to be the endpoint. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
So is this the same? Okay. Is this the same issue as payload type?
Sounds like an STP problem.
this is a different topic than what I want to nail right here.
All right, I was going to agree with Emil that anything where you're going to use header extensions for congestion control purposes between
I agree with Emil too. So here, let me throw this out as a proposal. In the draft is we say all the existing things are allowed if you receive them. If you receive two of them, you use the hop by hop value, not the
Here's the question.
And future extensions, if they're not allowed, can define themselves on a list of things.
Does double actually have a way of doing end to end at this point?
Because it's inserted before things that come after the OBH header are allowed to be changed, things before aren't. So you can tell who inserted it.
Okay, so we don't have
you can integrity check and you
okay,
can.
Okay, so we don't have end-to-end confidentiality of these at this point, right?
Using the usual confidentiality mechanisms that are painful in header extensions, we have both levels of confidentiality.
I don't believe you.
Okay.
Because I designed that so badly.
I thought it was just hard, not impossible.
It's hard until you start. Basically, the problem is that it depends on where the. Once you start adding more header extensions, you have to figure out what the exact original list and order of header extensions was to get the mask right.
Yes, and we do all of that. We have it we'll take it offline, but I think I can convince you it works with a brilliant design done by somebody. We don't mess up the orders of the header, and we know which ones were in the. We can reconstruct exactly the headers that arrived at that the original person sent.
All right. Yeah. In that case, yes, you can do it. And it's even more annoying than the usual way.
Yes. Yes. It's doubly annoying. That's what it's called. Double. Yeah. So it sounds like we've got the default answer should be yes. And the answer for unknown things is certainly yes. Is there anything in the no category? Otherwise, I'm just going to write this draft up as basically yes.
I'm sorry, this is yes, you use the hop by hop value?
Yes, you're allowed to, the mixer's allowed to change all of these basically.
Overwrite the end to end.
Overwrite the end to end one, yeah.
Harald Ostrom, is there any extension for which there's a security concern if the forwarder is able to rewrite it?
I think both Jonathan and I went through those and read them and couldn't, and it didn't look like it to either of us, but if there is, it clearly has to be listed here as and checked as not allowed. And there may be ones in the future too, right? We gotta.
If we're okay with stating that PERC does not give any security guarantees on header extensions against sabotage by the middle box, then we're fine.
Okay.
Ronnie Evans, so here's the problem. The client to mixer one, then on one hand, the mixer needs to see it. On the other hand, it shouldn't change the value because that will be like changing who you will see, which is like the splicing thing that you have.
But I mean, it doesn't matter if it changes that value to the endpoint because the endpoint shouldn't be using it, right?
I mean, no, but the receiver can, I mean, if he's transferring all the audio, then if the receiver is deciding, I mean, he wants to decide how to, which audio to show,
right.
Then if it will decide to, it may send audio of someone else instead of the audio of the
viewer. So let's just propose that one should be in the no category then. That's fine with me.
Yeah, but it's not going to be encrypted.
That's fine. I totally understand. It's just integrity protected and it's not right. So if what we're going to say is basically the media distributor can read that value, but if it changes it and inserts a new one, that the client should ignore the new one and should use the original one. That's what the text will say, right? And so that was So can we just capture that the client to mixer media level will be in that no category at the bottom? Audio level, yeah, thanks. Okay, I think we've killed that one. That's good advice. That was one of the real open issues on it. We've discussed that one to death, so no need for that. And that's it.
All right.
Any other issues people want to raise about open issues about this draft that people want to raise?
Robert is not going to the microphone.
John, thanks. I mean, maybe this is a little bit related to your X here, which is to say, I think in Emil's architecture, if we rewrite SRCs, then it will also be useful to rewrite timestamps. Same mechanism. So, but I think that's much less of a security consideration for you because that's just like sequence numbers.
Right. I mean, This the draft is like how we would change this draft to support both those changes is really obvious, right? We just, allow it to change them. We keep the original values and the original header values. So, the changes to this draft to support Emil's plan is very minimal.
Yeah.
So that's not a big deal.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that if we do that, then we'd also
probably need timestamps as well. Yeah. Okay. But I mean, I think that's what I'm asking Emil for is like, hey, write down all the stuff we're going to need to make this work. Yeah. That's it.
All right. Thank you, Colin. Next up is Tunnel, which I think is Paul. Let me see. Take it away.
Okay. All right. So this is just a summary of what's changed in the 03 draft. So hopefully you can hear me this time. We modified the size, modified the protocol, reduced the size of the messages. That was one thing that we did. And that was primarily to address the MTU issues. And there's a section that was added on MTU. We added the protocol changed a little bit, so we also have a data type registry we proposed for IANA, and we changed terminology. And that's basically it. That was changed on the draft. Let me go to the next slide. So the more important stuff that I want to talk about is not so much that what we changed on the draft, which we can go through in detail. I've got backup slides if we wanted, but I don't think we need to spend time for that. The real question is here. So using DTLS between the key distributor and the media distributor presents certain net firewall challenges, in particular for web browsers that want to have the key distributor built into the browser on one of the endpoints. So we got net firewall stuff to deal with. The current protocol is limited in terms of extensibility. And the primary reason for that is that we're associating certain messages with certain DTLS events. And that limits the opportunity for the key manager to send down a message for the key distributor to send certain messages to the media distributor at some arbitrary point in time. That's really the issue. So we don't have a need in the protocol today for that, but should we don't have a way to do it. So then the question to the group is, there's also a point here on DTLS 1.3. So the way that 1.3 is actually going to change is probably going to mean that the way that we have the protocol currently designed won't work. There's an easy fix for it in that you change it to say that you can send these messages when you send the EKT message down to the endpoint. So there's a solution, but in general, it's still a good idea to kind of get away from having a dependency on the behavior of DTLS for the protocol. So it's been proposed, we had discussions on the list this last week or this week, that we have either a TLS connection or maybe a data channel. If you want to go to the next slide. So the first proposal is maybe we consider replacing the tunnel protocol with a TLS connection. And over that TLS connection, we would have a fairly trivial protocol. It wouldn't be complicated. It would look a whole lot like what's in the current draft now. And we could replace the thing that's called the association ID. And actually, for this, we'd still have the association ID. But we could use association ID 0 to indicate that this is a specific message that relates to all of the DTLS associations. For example, rather than have the MDD advertise its supported profiles with every DTLS connection, it can do that one time when it sets up the connection. So you can go to the next slide. So this could be the protocol, right? If we run it over TLS, we could have this. There'd be an association identifier, and then basically it's a tag length value message that follows. And of course, this is just something very simple I put together. The next slide, this just shows what the flow would look like if we're using TLS. So you set up the TLS connection, and then you send over the supported profiles, and then you've got all the tunneling messages that go back and forth. Next slide. All right, so the other alternative is that we use a WebRTC data channel. And the reason for this proposal is that web browsers are already going to have a data channel. They've got all the stack built into the browser anyway. This would put a certain amount of additional effort on the key distributor, because the key distributor wouldn't, I wouldn't expect a key distributor today to certainly have a data channel stack. So there is going to be a certain amount of work. We have to get that chunk of stuff put into the key distributor. But we can also get rid of the association identifier, and we can actually use the stream ID in place of that. So that would be a nice thing. That would actually reduce the protocol a little bit in terms of complexity. So we get rid of an additional identifier, just use the stream ID that's in SCTP. And again, we can have a fairly trivial protocol. So if you look at the next slide, these are a few of the options I looked at for data channels. We could have n different reliable SCTP channels. We could have n different unreliable SCTP channels plus one control channel. And we could have one reliable stream over which we send everything, which would sort of look like the way the SCTP or the TCP at the TLS example looked like. So these are three options. There may be some others that I didn't think to enumerate. So Ecker, you have a question?
Yeah, so I guess as two things. First of all, I guess there seems to be an implicit assumption that there has to be exactly one channel, and I don't understand why that would be the case. There's a much more natural design here, which is to have one thing, have one channel over which the DTLS stuff is tunneled, and then use web services to carry all the control information. I guess I don't understand, like, why are we trying? Why everyone else, like the entire ITF, when they want to design like a channel, like a control system, like uses the web. And so why are we like not doing that?
So why are we not having there's 30 participants in the conference, and you're asking why we don't open 30 channels?
No, you seem to be assuming, though that would actually be fine too, but you seem to be assuming that the DTLS packets that are being tunneled have to go over the same channel as the control information that goes back and forth to the MDD. Why?
Well, there was a decision made to use DTLS SRTP to the MDD, right? Now the question is, how do we get that data packets to the key manager, right? So
yes.
So then the question, you could open one channel per DTLS.
I'm not debating that. What I'm saying, I mean, I'm happy to do it on the other point, but I'm not for now. What I'm saying is that there are two classes of information here. There's the information which is being just transited through the MDD and essentially being synced into the and then being synced into the KMF. And then there is the information that is being sent from the KMF to the MDD directly to control the MDD. And, or frankly, the other way around, in probably any putative future design. Those do not have to be on the same network connection. And so the ones that are on the same, the DTLS packets and any RTP packets you might be sending that are just being forwarded back and forth to the MDD, absent the sort of networking considerations that Colin raised about having multiple NATs, it would actually be very natural to simply have N connections. And the only reason not to do that is these like port exhaustion and networking issues. But it's extremely unnatural to have the control channel be over that channel. That's not how you would ordinarily design things. So why are you assuming these have to be in the same network connection?
Well, the primary reason was we're coupling the DTLS SRTP traffic with the control traffic that comes back to the MDD, because in the original design, we're using DTLS just raw over the wire, right?
Yeah.
And so it fit well, right? Another reason is if you're able to keep the DTLS traffic and the key information that the MDD needs somewhat coupled together, there's convenience in that. If you don't do that, then I mean you could have a completely separate connection of whatever sort. It wouldn't matter. But you know, then the question is, what would be the benefit of doing that?
Benefit of doing that would be that then you could conveniently use HTTPS REST to do for the control channel, so which makes like the system much easier to work on. Well, I mean, you have one thing, which is basically like a low-level networking thing, which just has to tunnel the DTLS packets in and out. And I say the only reason not to have that in individual connections is like basically network operational issues.
Well, REST.
I think we can use HTTP REST either way. Like, there's one question, architectural question, is do we put these two things in the same thing or not? But even if we're just using HTTP REST, right? Because of the direction of the initiation of the connection from the KMF to the MDD, that will have to have a WebSocket or something like that to get the messages so that the MDD can hand the messages back, the DTLS messages back to it, right?
You have to do that, but I guess it just seems like very odd that there's compelling reasons in an application environment to use HTTP interfaces for control. And those reasons do not obtain to the networking of plumbing the DTLS packets around. So like, there's the stuff that's up here that is control, and the stuff that's down here that is networking, and so the two designs, when you put them on the same channel, then either you take the control stuff and you drive it all the way down to the ridiculous networking stuff, or you take the network stuff and drive it all the way to the control channel and back down, and none of those makes any sense.
So maybe we should get away from this word control channel. The only thing we're doing is exchanging keys. So there's an exchange
today,
and there's an advertisement of the supported profiles on the MDD.
Yeah. So, that's control.
Right. But we're sending the DTL. We're just doing key exchange, right? And the keys that are sent to the MDD are tightly coupled with the keys that are associated with those DTLS packets that are coming through. You can't use HTTP because you can't get through the firewall, right? You could from the browser to the MDD, but you can't from the MDD to the browser.
No, I understand. What I'm saying is you pull up a TLS connection or something between the KMF and the MDD, and right. use that for all the DTLS packets, and you pull up a web services connection, or whatever HTTPS and websockets if you need notifications, and use that for all the control traffic, and you have identifiers that tie those two together.
Yeah, you could do that.
Right. Why would you not do that?
I welcome your internet.
Versus just using either using a TLS connection like option one.
Yeah.
Or using a data channel. I mean, either one of those you get.
Well, because the data channels were task, and this is requiring you to design this like control protocol, which now needs to be managed.
Why wouldn't you just send the DTLS? The DTLS is just like, I have some data, I need to send it to you. The other guy has some data, we send it to me. That's exactly the same as control channel. Why wouldn't you just send the DTLS stuff over REST as well, ignoring how you do the control?
Because I've actually implemented the software. because from a networking perspective, then you have to somehow arrange to tunnel that crap all the way up the HTTP layer and back down again. It's just silly. Like,
no.
Just think about how the implementation actually works in your stack.
Yeah, I got a packet. I got some data. Yeah. A block of binary data that I need to send to a server. Like, I put that in base64 and go and send it.
Like, so. Having thought a little bit about how to implement this, like the DTLS packets you're getting are not like they're tunneled things. They're not like you don't have the stack you're passing into hooked up to the wire. You've got this hermetic DTLS stack that you're passing in and out. So it's like inherently application layer because it's not wired to the network at all. And so pass it however you like. I think the more interesting thing is like you do need this async. You need the server to be the MDD to be able to asynchronously send stuff out to the KMF. So they think the transport properties are much more interesting than the layering properties.
Well, I mean,
So to me, it seems clear that like a REST API would, I totally see how a REST API makes sense for fetching the capabilities of the server and posting keys up to the server. Like, but it's not really clear to me that passing DTLS messages around in HTTP makes sense from a transport point of view, not from a any sort of layering argument.
Well, okay. So, I mean, I guess maybe I have the unusual advantage of actually having implemented the stack in Firefox. So I know how it works. But there's like a bunch of straightforward networking crap in transport layer that doing the TLS tunneling would be extremely straightforward if you just stack transport layers directly. But if I have to plumb that crap in the HTTP stack, it's going to be an enormous hassle. So, like. Okay. Like, have you looked at transport? Like, it's incredibly straightforward to do the TLS, TLS layering. And if I had to put that in WebSocket, it's going to be a nightmare. Is it going to go Necco?
Yeah, no, it's for our architecture, that's correct.
But I mean, that's like how cool works too. Okay.
So what's your proposal is that it goes over TLS?
My proposal would be to have one protocol, which is a simple encapsulation protocol, whose only job it is to take the DTLS packets and associate them to some connection identifier, and you use it. There's an outbound TLS connection from the KMF to the MDD, and all of the DTLS traffic is carried over that, and all there is affiliation information to pass to frame those DTLS connections, and then there's an entirely separate web services interface which is defined for control.
So can we go back a few slides to the previous proposal?
This one?
No, keep going back to that one. So right there, one more forward. So it's basically that one, except without message three, right? It's just like, that's just a TLS protocol with that, about that level of framing information.
Just message one.
Yes, sure, right, okay, with just message one.
And then everything in messages two and three, like gets turned into some REST call.
Some REST thing.
If there's some reason that's sucky, I'd like to hear about it, but I just don't understand what the... I guess everybody's looking at me like I have two heads, so maybe I'm wrong, but...
Doing that will work, but you just end up creating two interfaces instead of one, right? I just don't see the benefit of doing that.
You just need to, and you have to guarantee they share on them.
Why? Why?
One gets load balanced one way, one gets load balanced the other way. It's definitely not going to work, right? They won't be going to this same. But I mean, we work around all that.
I mean, so I guess. No, I'm actually quite surprised you how you're being offered. You mean, so your concern is that like, your concern is that you're going to load balance these systems and they're not going to crosstalk between the control channel and that thing that's telling the DTLS, that's your concern?
You guys are probably going to solve this. Yeah.
I mean, plus like the way modern cloud architectures work, you end up with queues all over the place anyway, right? I mean, like, I guess my concern is like, the notion that we're going to define some like new binary protocol that like will be a hassle to work on when every other time we try to design protocols for these kinds of application layer semantic messages, we like do it in HTTP, just like straight from the extraordinarily odd. That's my design motivation. Is now, yes. If we're choosing between these two things with those two channels, then like clearly the TLS one is dominant.
There's one channel.
So yeah. I think it works. I think the reason you're getting kind of an odd reaction is that in a vacuum, saying use web services for this would be fine if it were sufficient, but it's not sufficient. We need more than that, obviously. And so the prospect that then we have something where we could do a solution that takes care of all of it, or we could do a solution that takes care of some of it and then throw web services in, almost feels a little gratuitous. It almost seems like we're pushing that in artificially. So... Right. But for what we have, I mean, this kind of an approach seems right. I'm sensitive to that we don't want to like invent our own binary protocol. If we can come up with something here that worked a little more, you know, standard, like maybe we could just throw CBOR over this instead of coming up with our own TLS.
Yeah, obviously any sane person would put CBOR or JSON here.
It's
CBOR here.
But
well, yeah, anywhere. But I, yeah.
So I think keeping it to a single connection, just it architecturally makes a lot more sense. But aside from that, I mean, the general approach of one connection, TLS, sending stuff back and forth with different message types to accommodate these three different functions and potentially more in the future, I think that holds together, and I think it's very future proof.
I think it'll work. I just think it's off. I think that
yes, of between these two designs, like the one that's the TLS channel is like clearly like much better. Like I don't really want to do like this SDB nonsense. So yes, I think that is a better design. And though I far rather define these messages in some CBOR or some other format or JSON that have that have sort of bit packing on the wire. I guess I'm just sort of trying to think about how people like now think about designing software, right? And componentizing it is just sort of the way it's kind of done. But fine, like people don't like want to do it that way, then like I don't really care that much.
So I guess we beat that horse, but I don't have a resolution. So I think there's agreement to have a single connection. And then the question is whether we want to have TLS or we want to use data channels.
I didn't actually hear anyone up here speaking in favor of data channels. I've kind of changed my view on that as well. I no longer think it's a good idea. Okay. Ecker spoke kind of strongly against them, and I think he was the one who came with the idea in the first place. So I really think that any of the proponents were, you know, kind of washed out in that conversation. Okay, so I think we're down to a single TLS connection. We're down to talking about what the format and framing of that's going to look like. And this is not the place for that. It's an on-list discussion.
Right, and I don't take it as a foregone conclusion whether it's one connection or two, right? Like with TLS, like we could have TLS in separate web services. Are you come to a conclusion on that?
I don't feel strongly about it, but it feels like the wrong direction.
So are we in agreement at least that the tunneling of the DTLS messages, as opposed to the controls messages, is appropriate for should just be done over TLS, some simple framing over over TLS. Thumbs up.
Probably the only way to do it.
Okay.
Just Mike Live. Yeah. So, and I think that what that does tell you is that regardless of the whether you want to have two channels or one, you will need an association ID. You know, some way to talk about those DTLS connections, which I think is in your slide, because now they're not being associated with anything inherently, and you don't have multi-stream anymore, right?
Yep. Okay. All right, so I'll start working on text that goes along these lines, and we can hash it out on the list or in the interim meetings.
All right.
Okay. Thanks a lot,
Paul. All right, and our last topic is EKT. We have 23 minutes. And I will pull up your Google slides.
I don't think I changed these ones on you.
Maybe.
Okay, next slide. So there was very little changes on this here. Key is distributed, it can also have time to live, may have done this wrong. We need to go back and look at that in some more detail, but the idea was to make sure that what we agreed on the last meeting was that we need mechanisms such that if the way to distribute a new key got DOSed for some reason, you didn't just keep using the old key forever. So we'll go back and review this, see if we got it right. And we added the stuff that, remember we had a long conversation about synchronization of keys, and we just went with the simplest scheme possible, which is basically when you get a new key, you don't start using it for 250 milliseconds, so you're pretty sure that everyone else has it by the time you start using it. We agreed at this last meeting. So those were the changes we tried to make. Next slide. As I started to add this time to live stuff, a little bit of discussion with people on side led to the quickly, like some people had thought it was an absolute time, some people thought it was relative, I'd assumed it was relative time. I always get a little bit scared with absolute times because now we have the whole discussion of time, how you get it. So, I mean, anyone have any, like, any strong opinions on this? Give me some advice of which way we should go on this. Anyone? Relative? Anyone? Yeah, okay. It seemed like no one cared when I was writing it, and so I'm going to leave it as relative unless somebody speaks in favor. Next. We need to discuss extensibility at some point on this. We could add new messages in there. My proposal, I would just add something in. I was going to make it sort of, you know, you needed ITF review or something as a default policy for extensions in this one, as it seemed like it should be basically that type of approach. Anyone have any other thoughts on that? Back to email. I think that's pretty much next slide, and I think we're pretty much... I think the more... Cisco and some other companies have some old implementations of the EKT from several years ago, right? But the more we really think about this, like, we can deal with all of this signaling. It's probably not a real interop problem. I think that I'm going to basically ignore this unless some other vendor shows up and says, no, we need you to not choose code points that mess up with stuff we shipped long ago. It seems to us mostly we'll solve that with signaling.
I don't have a problem with that, but you could also, like, start from the other end.
Sorry?
I don't have a problem with that, but you could also, like, start from the other end or something.
Yeah.
I guess... If there's some, unless, or, I mean, if this is purely a matter of, like, you want to start 0123 instead of, like, 255, you know, 254, like, you know, I guess, like, I don't, there's no reason to stomp on those code points, I don't think, unless there's some risk.
How big a code point space are we talking about here?
Probably a single byte, and there's probably only one code point that's been used out of it, and we could mark that one code point as, like, you know, don't use this one right away, wait a while.
That's kind of, yeah, kind of what I'm thinking.
Yeah, okay. Let's just do that. I don't. Yeah, unpreferred. I'll investigate that a little bit as I write this up and try and figure out if there's something logical. Next slide.
I think that's the last one.
That's the last one. Yeah. So, other things on this draft before it's ready for working group last call.
I just had one question about this. So one question on that because I haven't paid enough attention. This is all stuff. These are all code points that are inside the encryption, right? Or are they outside the encryption? Because if they're outside the encryption, having, you know, Wireshark be able to just disambiguate them would not be a bad thing.
They're outside.
Okay, in that case, I think just keep them out, so just so that the Wireshark doesn't have to look, see the signaling to figure out which flavor it is, maybe.
That's a really good point I hadn't thought of. Thank you. Yeah. Okay.
So and if we're talking about a single octet code point space, we should probably have a fairly restrictive
policy. Yeah. Right. I can't really imagine ever changing without, like, effectively a, you know, an update to the EKT mechanism at ITF, right? That's when it would change.
Did you register?
I think it's a very convenient way of managing the spot. But yeah.
Yeah.
Other questions about EKT? We've had really very little feedback on the list. I probably need to get. We're probably getting close to the point of not exactly working group last call, I was joking about that, but getting some people to, you know, go through and review it carefully.
So I'm not seeing a bunch of big technical changes being proposed in this round.
No, well, this is we're cleaning up nits.
Would this be an appropriate point in time for people to do some reviews of it?
Yeah.
Could I have a couple of volunteers to do reviews?
Thank you,
Ecker. Ecker volunteers, Russ volunteers, Jonathan.
It's short. It's been on a diet. It's short now.
Okay, Jonathan. All right. Thanks. Okay. So that'd be good to just sort of flush out any major issues that we need to address before working group last call.
When?
Say that again, Russ.
When?
End of August.
Okay. Sounds good.
Yes.
Thank you.
Note takers, please also reflect that end of August date. All right, that brings us to the end of our scheduled agenda. We were actually a little short. Does anyone have any other business they'd like to discuss with this group now? Yeah, I mean, we could argue about SSRCs a little bit more if people really have energy left for that. Otherwise, we'll just wait for Emil's draft. All right, I will declare us adjourned then. Thank you very much. I have one blue sheet here. Where is the other one? And if anyone has not signed the blue sheets, please come forward now.
WebRTC is canceled in favor
of RTC. Well,
I can't even hear a different thing to say. That's true.